thanks this day that you have brought us here to worship and that you have prepared this word for us this day. So God, I pray that the Holy Spirit, who is active and present among us, work in us now, O Lord. Open our ears and prepare our hearts so that we might receive this day what you have for us. Help us, O Lord, to be ready and to meet you here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I hope you were listening to the children's sermon, because there's a wonderful message there from this parable. A wonderful message about the way in which God has given each one of us unique abilities and talents and gifts. And he calls us to use those. He calls us to grow those so that what he has placed in our hands might increase for his glory. I think it's a wonderful message, and it's one that I've actually preached from this particular passage before. But one of the great things about Scripture, one of the wonderful things about the way the Holy Spirit works through the Bible, is that we encounter different messages from the very same passage of Scripture. From the very same words, we read it one time, and there God is speaking something to us. And we read it, and we come back another time, and there's something else that God is raising up, highlighting, showing us in Scripture. And so, this morning, I want to go a slightly different place than we went with the children just a few moments ago. I want to talk to you a little bit about the context of exactly what Jesus was saying there in this parable. See, this comes after a couple chapters. In the 24th and 25th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus is talking to his disciples. In the beginning of the 24th chapter, it says, the disciples came to him privately and were asking him some questions. And then there were all of these parables, the one we read last week, the one we're going to read next week, all of these things Jesus was talking to them about, trying to get them ready for the time that was coming very soon, when he would be crucified, when he would be resurrected, and he would ascend to the Father, and then they would be out on their own. And so he was telling them these stories, his disciples, his closest followers, the ones who had been with him the longest and seen the most of what he'd done. There he was telling these stories. And so what is he telling them in this parable? Well, certainly I think he was telling them what we have heard, and you've maybe heard in other sermons about this parable. He's telling them that in your hands have been placed many gifts and talents and abilities, and you should use them. But I think this week when I was looking at this, I noticed one thing that I don't think I'd really noticed before. The parable says the master entrusted his wealth to his servants as he was preparing to go away. And it got me thinking and wondering, what is the wealth of Jesus? What is the thing that Jesus entrusted in the hands of the disciples when he went away on his journey? I think the answer to that question is the mission, the church. Jesus was going away, and he was leaving with the church the most precious thing that he had. He was leaving with the disciples the most precious thing he had, the church that he had died to create. And so he was telling them, I'm about to place in your hands this thing that I've come, this thing that I've walked among you to create, this thing I'm about to go to the cross to begin, and I'm leaving it in your hands. I'm entrusting it to you. And I expect when I come back, I expect when you see me again, to have more church given back to me than I gave to you. I expect that when I come back and when you see me again, that I will get more church back than I gave to you disciples. See, because that church he gave them when it started was very small. After the resurrection, after the ascension, it was down to just a few folks. You know, he had crowds and crowds and crowds following him during his earthly ministry, but when they saw what happened to him in Jerusalem, when they saw his beating, when they saw his crucifixion, almost all of them wandered away. Even famously, Peter denies him. And so when the day of Pentecost comes and the church comes into being with the Holy Spirit poured out upon us, you ever had anyone place something really precious in your hands? Something they really valued and they really cared about? Have you ever had anyone do that? Do you feel the sense of honor and privilege and responsibility? You know, a little less than 2 years ago, we had a baby put in our hands. And in that moment, you realize, oh my gosh, I'm responsible for this person for the rest of their life. How much more? What a great privilege is it to be the ones that Jesus Christ put the church in our hands and said to us, I want you to be the ones to carry on this mission that I began. So what a privilege it is that we have. And in the parable, he tells us we have the ability to do what he calls us to do. It says that he gave to each according to their abilities. And so he gave to us here, Sheridan, what we need to do what he calls us to do. He saw and he knows what we are capable of as a people with his help. And he has placed in our hands the things we need to do. I know these days sometimes it can feel challenging and difficult to be the church. You know, we live in a culture that's different than it was when some of you were younger. And you remember when the church was held in respect and honor and people just went to church because it was the thing you did. And they don't do that anymore. In fact, we live in a country now where sometimes you are ridiculed and mocked and criticized for being people who go to church. It is harder and it is more difficult. But God sees what we have here. God has given us the ability to do what he calls us to do, and God is not wrong. And so we believe that he has placed in our hands what we need to do his mission. You know, it's harder to be the church today than it used to be, but it's not as hard as it has been in some places. You know, there are times in the history of the church when the persecutors of the church would take Christians and they would light them on fire to light up the Colosseum. Well, it's not that hard to be a Christian these days. And so while we might be a little bit of a mind that, you know, it used to be easier, that doesn't mean we can't do the work. God has given us the ability we need to do what he calls us to do. Because he asks us, he tells us in this parable, I expect more church back than what I gave you. God expects more church here in Sheridan back than what he gave us when we got here. In the coming generations, he expects us to hand on a church that is more than the church is right now, and he has given us the ability to do that, and all that we have to do is believe and work and follow him. You know, I've served a lot of churches in my day, and in my 15 years of ministry. I remember once talking to a lady, a sweet old saint of a church I was serving, a little country church, and we were talking about the fact that that church had seen decline over decline over decline over the years, and the people had become dispirited, and she said to me these words that I still remember. She said, well, I guess as long as the church stays open until I die, that'll be good. That's not what Jesus says. I understand that spirit of defeat that can come over the church in these days in particular. All the other things we're battling in addition to the coronavirus. But God has given us the ability to do what he calls us to do. And he calls us to give more church back than he gave to us. And so the question that I want to hear, or the question I ask myself, is what will Jesus say to me when I see him? You know, in that parable, two out of the three of the people who he handed those talents, that bag of money over to, two of the three of them, he said, well done, my good and faithful servant. I want him to say well done to us here, Sheridan. I want him to be able to look on us when we meet him, whenever that is, and say, well done. I gave you that church. I nurtured it through all those decades before you got there, and you left more church than you found. So I know the Holy Spirit is still with us and still guiding us and still leading us. And right now, even as I speak, some of you have ideas. Some some of you have visions for where this church might grow and how it might go and how we might reach out and become more than we are right now. I would pray that you would not shy away from sharing those thoughts. I would pray that you would lean into that vision that God is giving you, because he has given us the ability to be more of a church than we are today. He is calling us to do that. And I know for one, I want him to say, well done, Sheridan UMC. Well done. Thank you for doing what I call you to do. I hope that you want to hear that as well. I hope that together we might make that happen with God's help. Let us pray. Lord, we do live on as the descendants of those first disciples who were given this charge. I have placed the church in your hands, and I expect you to hand off more than you have received. And so, O Lord, help us to dream and to imagine, even in a time in which it is easy to become defeated about what is going on in the world around us. Help us to remember, O Lord, that you have placed in our hands the abilities to do the things you call us to do. So, God, fill us by your Holy Spirit. Inspire us with the vision that Christ first gave those disciples. Because we know the need is still here among us, O Lord. And there are those who need to know the good news of Jesus Christ. Help us to be that good news in this community, so that the church that we hand on to the next generation might be greater than the church that you placed in our hands. In Jesus' name we pray today.